Good morning. Good morning, everyone. It's so good to see everybody online and here on this beautiful day in the pavilion. And wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome and wanted here today and every day.
So today's moment of focus is from the book Speaking the Truth by Dr. James Cone. If you don't know who Dr. James Cone is, he is no longer with us, unfortunately, but he is the father of Black liberation theology. Christians have no choice but to join the movement of liberation on the side of the poor, fighting against the structures of injustice. Faith in Jesus Christ, therefore, is not only an affirmation that we utter in Sunday worship and at other church gatherings. Faith is a commitment, a deeply felt experience of being called by the Spirit of Christ to bear witness to God's coming liberation by fighting for the freedom of the poor now. And with that, we will go into our song, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise. Till now we stand at last. west, where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our wearies, God of our silent tears, God who has brought us thus far on the way, God who
today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 to 16, and I am reading from the Inclusive Bible. Still, there is a certain wisdom which we express among the spiritually mature. It is not a wisdom of this age, however, nor of the rulers of this age who are headed for destruction. No, what we utter is God's wisdom, a mysterious, hidden wisdom. Yet God has revealed this wisdom to us through the Holy Spirit. She searches out all things, even the deep things of God. After all, no one knows one's thoughts except one's own inner spirit. By the same token, no one knows God's thoughts except God's Spirit. People without the Spirit do not accept what the Spirit of God teaches. Such teachings seem like foolishness to them because they can't understand them. We, however, have the mind of Christ. So this passage from 1 Corinthians is an interesting and powerful passage for many reasons, I think. And of course, some of those reasons we will talk about this morning. However, a little background, I think, needs to be discussed before we do that. Shocker, right? I'm always giving background on the passages. Because it's important to point out, I think, that 1 Corinthians was written by the Apostle Paul. And while this might seem obvious to some, sort of like, duh, it's actually a trickier statement to make than some might realize, actually. Next to Jesus himself, the Apostle Paul was arguably the most influential person with regard to the development of the early Christianity. 13 of the New Testament's 27 books, almost half, claim to be written by the Apostle Paul. And the book of Hebrews was accepted into the biblical canon only after it was suggested that Paul had written it, even though the book itself does not claim that title or claim that authorship. And if you count the book of Acts, where Paul is kind of the main protagonist within the book, then well over half of the books in the New Testament, 15 out of the 27 books are directly or indirectly related to Paul. But as is often the case with attributions of ancient writings, things aren't always as they appear. Very long story short, many religious historians have divided the works ascribed to Paul into three categories. Actually, there's a funny meme online that I saw a couple weeks ago that said the Pauline epistles are divided into two topics. One is Paul saying, Jesus is lovely, Jesus is wonderful, you should follow Jesus. And the other one is when he's writing to the church and saying, would you people just stop doing that sick shit for a little bit, for a little bit, please? And that is, Paul's epistle writings to the churches. It's just stop doing what you're doing, please. But as is often the case, we make assumptions particularly within the church. We're told something is, and we just sort of believe it. But within academia, within biblical history and the study of biblical history, there is some contention as to which books are Paul's and which aren't. So there are three main categories that we put the Pauline writings into. And the first category is the called the pastoral epistles. And this includes 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus, and they're called the pastoral epistles because they talk about what it takes to be a good deacon, a good pastor, whatever the position is. It's Paul teaching people how to work inside the church. And most scholars, due to the writing style, due to the vocabulary that's used, and the theology that is expressed in those letters, believe that Paul actually did not write these books, these letters. But rather, these writings came from someone wanting to use Paul's authority to get their point across, and you probably using Paul's authority without Paul's permission, maybe even after Paul died, because they wanted to convey a different message than what was previously being said, but they wanted to use Paul's authority to convince people that this is what you need to believe. The important historical issue with the pastoral epistles is that their teachings, like I said, often contradict well-known Pauline theology. That's how we can know it probably wasn't Paul. And that's our dead giveaway. The second category is the Deutero-Pauline epistles, which include Ephesians, Colossians, and 2 Thessalonians. Deutero here means second. And that's because these were not written by Paul, most likely, but by a second Paul, meaning that someone working with Paul's permission, perhaps an apprentice or something like that. Perhaps when Paul was in prison, he at times didn't have writing materials, or perhaps as he grew ill, Paul talked about the thorn in his side, and most people believe that was a reference to a health issue. So Paul may have had an apprentice who wrote his messages for him, but in that apprentice's own style. And the third category is the undisputed Pauline epistles, which include Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Philippians, 1st Thessalonians, and Philemon. And scholars tend to be fairly unanimous that Paul wrote these letters himself. Now, why is this history lesson important? Well, aside from understanding the roots of our religious and theological teachings, we can be fairly certain that today's passage from 1 Corinthians is the actual thinking of Paul, barring, of course, centuries of transcription errors and translation deviations and people down the line editing Paul in a certain way or rephrasing things because they think it needs to be said in a certain way. Because believe it or not, that's what happened to Scripture throughout history. It got changed and transformed. But we can know that Paul wrote this. Side note, if this type of stuff interests you, I'm going to be doing a study this fall, looking at a critical historical examination of the New Testament. Cheap plug. So if you want to do that, I'll be doing that after church every Sunday through September and October. But there'll be more information on that. So yes, Paul wrote today's message. This passage that speaks of many things, but in particular, humility and wisdom and how it all relates to the mind of the Christ. And theologian Charles Campbell explains that Paul here, when writing of these things, when Paul writes, we speak of wisdom, though it is not the wisdom of this age, that that when writing this, Paul was intentionally challenging the dominant order of the ancient world by using the ancient world's own symbols. When I talk about the ancient world, I'm talking about Athens, Greece, these areas where people, intellectuals gathered and they debated. And Paul, and so the mind was very important in those areas. So Paul is using the symbol of the mind. And then what Paul is now trying to do by using the symbol of the mind is they're now trying to subvert it. Campbell writes this. He says, quote, "The notion of the mind was deeply rooted in the hierarchical assumptions of Paul's world. After the spirit, the mind was the highest ranking member of the human body. It represented a superior activity of a human being. In addition, understandings of the mind also reinforced," and here's the important part, "it reinforced social hierarchies, including gender hierarchies. Only the highest male social elites would be expected to exercise the full capacities of the mind," unquote. Now, while this issue of powerful men being trusted to think was a reality during Paul's time, I don't believe it's too much of an exaggeration to say that the same hierarchy exists today. The difficult truth is that there are biases embedded within our society against the value of the collective wisdom of oppressed and marginalized communities, where some people are viewed naturally, quote unquote, naturally, smarter or wiser than others simply due to their socioeconomic placement or their gender or even their skin color. I mean, it's 2022 and we're still dealing in this country with racist systems that affect and restrict the access of educational opportunities for people of color. Not to mention the embedded racist ideology that white people are simply born smarter than people of color. Keep in mind, it wasn't that long ago when a popular Democratic presidential nominee by the name of Joe Biden said that how amazed he was at how bright and articulate and clean then candidate Barack Obama was. He was amazed by how articulate that Obama was. And something I've also been thinking a lot about this week due to some events in my own life is that by and large, as a culture, we still place little value on the wisdom of emotions and intuition, traits that traditionally are associated with women. And we tend to view emotional IQ to be inferior with regard to being a source of knowledge, definitely inferior to what we consider objective reason that is normally traditionally associated with men. How many times have we heard that a woman could never serve effectively as president because of how emotional she'd be in office, which is the height of irony considering the last 4 years? Or how biased our culture remains in recognizing the wisdom and intelligence of people who are blind or deaf or in wheelchairs or who have ADD. This is not to say that as a culture, we have a problem showing compassion for people that veer from dominant perspectives of knowledge, although that might be true as well. But when it comes to actually changing those dominant views in order to make others equal, not so much. It's easy to say we shouldn't ridicule a woman for being emotional or crying at work, but it's more difficult for our culture to embrace the idea of emotions as actually a vital source of knowledge. As a result, we devalue the wisdom of women and other marginalized communities. And this in turn has the effect of cementing dominant identities of whiteness, of maleness, and an overinflated emphasis, and it hurts me to say this, but an overinflated emphasis on higher education. And these dominant identities of knowledge become normalized in their highest positions of power, whether that's the government, business, education, and yes, in religious leadership. So in today's passage, Paul reminds us of a different kind of knowledge, which is available to everyone. The knowledge to be found within the mind of the Christ. This mind, from which the wisdom of God can be discerned, belongs to any who seek it, because it is a gift from the divine, a gift of the divine. However, it's also important to note that the mind of the Christ is not specific to Christianity alone. Yes, we call it the mind of the Christ, but Buddhists call it Bodhi. In Islam and Sufism, it's referred to as Wadat al-Wujud. The Hindus call it Moksha. So please do not understand me saying this as a form of Christian exceptionalism, but rather the concept of divine wisdom under different names. And for us, as people who are Christians, it is the mind of the Christ. And the mind of the Christ is a new way of knowing, of thinking, of becoming. And this new way values whatever leads to collective flourishing and whatever is grounded in love and compassion and justice. It values the kinds of knowing that often come through the experience of oppression and marginalization. It values the kind of knowing that is only felt on an emotional level, and those kinds of feelings when you can't put language to those feelings. It's ineffable. Those kinds of knowing matter within the mind of the Christ. And to this, I'm going to go back to James Cone for a second, the father of Black liberation theology. James Cone wrote this: "To know Jesus is to encounter him in the history of the weak and the helpless. That is why it can be rightly said that there can be no knowledge of Jesus independent of the history and culture of the oppressed," unquote. And these experiences and accumulated knowledge of our marginalized communities not only matter, they are perhaps more important than what the dominant powers bring to the table. Because all of these marginalized sources of knowing, despite their inferior status in the eyes of the culture, these sources are the seedbed for the blossoming of life and community. They are the ways we bring balance to what has long been imbalanced. They are pathways into different ways of being, different ways of enlightenment that can help us to think and act and relate and live more openly for the betterment of all life. Dr. Cone goes on to say that the Black experience, in other words, the unique knowledge that emerges out of the marginalized Black community throughout history, that's the Black experience. And this experience is about a search for meaning when you don't have meaning in this world. The Black experience is about bringing balance to a community that has historically lived amidst the imbalance of marginalization, white supremacy, white privilege, and systemic racism. And Paul is telling us in our text today to find that balance, all of us, to find that balance amidst a world of imbalance, to find meaning in a world devoid of meaning, to embrace knowledge that often works counter to what we call common sense, but is nevertheless a pathway to growth and love and community. All of this requires trusting the mind of the Christ, or the ways of knowing that grow love, that this form of knowledge is of higher value than any other. Now, I want to come back real quick here to the historical figure of Paul for a second, because I think there's an interesting element to him that can add another layer to our understanding of this passage today. So, like I said, next to Jesus himself, the Apostle Paul was arguably the most important person in the development of early Christianity. Historians would argue he was more important, in all honesty, than Jesus, because Jesus had his thing, but Paul created a whole theology around Jesus, and it impacted the history of the church. But even though he and Jesus are the two most prominent figures within the New Testament, a question often emerges, like I just hinted at, amongst scholars, of whether these two figures even represented the same religion at all. Now, prior to the writing of the Gospels, and keep in mind that the earliest gospel, the Gospel of Mark, wasn't written until at least 75 years after the death of Jesus. So prior to Mark's writing, Christians were telling oral stories about Jesus, about the things he said and the things that he did and the things that he experienced. And of course, these stories get embellished and they grow, and stories get added, stories get subtracted. But a major question exists amongst historians as to whether these traditions and these stories about Jesus that circulated orally even made it to Paul's churches, the churches that Paul started. There was no internet. There was no mail service. You could live 10 miles away from a group of people and never, ever see them in your entire life, because 10 miles is a long way to walk. So Mark wasn't written until 75 years after the death of Jesus, which means it also wasn't written until about 30 or 40 years after Paul's missionary journeys. And what this means is that Paul did not have written access to anything about Jesus. It was all oral. And what Paul shares in his writings about the historical Jesus is very minimal. This is what Paul says about Jesus. Jesus was born of a woman, was born a Jew, had brothers, he had 12 disciples, he had a last meal with those disciples, and he died by crucifixion. And that's it. That's all Paul says about Jesus. Or at least about the history of Jesus. But he has a lot to say about the importance of Jesus, especially about the importance of his death and resurrection, and the belief that Paul had that his return was imminent. I talked a little bit a few weeks ago when I was talking about eroticism and the power of eroticism, and how Paul was anti-sex, basically. But Paul wasn't anti-sex because of some morality or some moralism that he held. He was anti-sex. He's like, you guys shouldn't be focusing on that. You should be focusing on this, because Jesus is coming back any minute now. So focus your energies over here to preparing the way for Jesus. So when Paul gets misinterpreted as being anti-sex or what have you, it's a misinterpretation. I mean, he might have been, I don't know. He might have been using that as an excuse, but that was the reason for Paul's, I guess, antagonism toward sexual intercourse. But in terms of historical information, there isn't much. Paul shares nothing about Jesus's early life, his birth, nothing of his baptism or temptation in the wilderness, nothing of his teaching about the coming kingdom of God, nothing of the parables told by Jesus. He didn't talk about any of the miracles, such as casting out demons or raising the dead. And you would think raising the dead would be one of those things that you talk about for a long, long time if you knew about it. His triumphal entry, Palm Sunday, cleansing of the temple, the trial before Pilate. There's just nothing substantial about Jesus's life in the writings of Paul. Now, whether this is a result of Paul not knowing the narrative details of Jesus, or if he just felt that they weren't important, neither of those things are necessarily important for us here today, or at least the point that I want to get across. I mean, it does matter for theologians and religious historians, but for this message, I wanted to point out that Paul's disregard of Jesus' tangible, physical life on earth is reflected in Paul's focus on the ramifications on the spirit and the mind of the Christ. Let me explain a bit more what I mean. In much of the four Gospels, we see a Jesus who is physically involved with his community. healing them, eating with them, speaking truth to power, advocating for justice, physically tearing apart the temple, weeping over loss, touching people, constantly touching people. When you read the Gospels, it's Jesus just touching people, giving people the comfort of physical touch. And while Paul does go into some requirements of right living within his writings, Paul is far, far more concerned with the resurrection and the return of Jesus and what that means for the transformation of our spirits and our minds. So there seems to be some disconnect between the physical presence of Jesus in the Gospels and Paul's focus on the spirit and the mind. This is so much the case that in Paul's letter to Philemon, Paul has the opportunity to condemn the institution of slavery. He has the opportunity to advocate for the release of a runaway slave. Spoiler alert, if you haven't read the book, he doesn't do either. He actually tells the slave that he should return to his master. So not only does Paul fail to condemn slavery in general, he doesn't even denounce in practice among Christians, in particular, the act of slavery. Philemon was a book that was often referenced by white slave owners in the South, saying it's biblical. And of course, Paul's actual writings show very little concern for most social inequalities. Despite his views that all are equal under the Christ, Paul didn't seem all that concerned about what we today call social justice. He maintained slaves should stay enslaved, that men should continue to dominate women, and that Christians remain in whatever social role they find themselves in, no matter how oppressive that social role might be. And this disregard by Paul for issues of physical justice was most likely, again, related to his belief and expectation that Jesus would be returning soon. Don't worry about if you're being oppressed. You're going to be taken up into the by and by soon enough. And therefore, Paul was focused far more on the spiritual than he was on the physical. So much so to the point that some theorize that Paul may have been a Gnostic Christian. Anyone know what a Gnostic Christian is? It was a form of Christianity. There were several different sects of Christianity that was developing in the ancient world, sort of battling for supremacy to see which form of Christianity would win out. I always tell my students when I'm teaching intro to New Testament, there is no such thing as Christianity. There's Christianities. Even in today's culture, that's why we have a gazillion denominations. That's why two pastors can have a coffee and be like this on their theology. There's Christianities. And Gnosticism was a sect that believed that everything material, everything you could touch, everything not spiritual was evil. But whether Paul was a Gnostic or not, we are faced with two very different Christianities here. The Christianity modeled in the Gospels, one focused on enfleshed love, the divine being made tangible in human form, enacting justice and mercy and compassion in this world to the point of death, and the Christianity taught by Paul, which sought spiritual and mental transformation on developing a spiritual humility that would lead to the mind of the Christ and thinking on the things above, not on earthly concerns. And while having the mind of the Christ also means growing in spiritual humility, it's also important to remember that spiritual humility, having the mind of the Christ, does not mean, and this is where we have to bring the two together, having the mind of the Christ, being focused on things spiritual, on enlightenment, on those issues, it does not mean shying away from the call of justice in this world. I know a lot of enlightened people who don't do anything for their community. They're focused on the internal. And that goes back to Dr. Cohn talking about balancing the imbalance. We need both. We need Jesus and we need Paul. While humility is certainly an important spiritual trait and central to a healthy relationship to God and others, it's also been historically misused by the church to silence voices of dissent and calls for justice and reforming society. If we're only focused on the spiritual, then when people enact or try to enact physical change, it can ruffle feathers when they're only about the spiritual goodness versus the tangible physical work that spiritual enlightenment should move us toward. If we are indeed in search of the mind of the Christ that Paul writes about, we should probably accept that it is Jesus who is our primary model for what the mind of the Christ looks like. And the mind of the Christ for Jesus compelled him into action to the point of death. Spiritual humility that Paul writes of is not meekness or silence or knowing your place or inaction. Waiting for Jesus to return to take care of all of our problems. I suspect Paul may have thought that it was going to happen soon and that these other things didn't need to be worried about. I want to think about the best of Paul. I like to think that Paul, if he realized that Jesus wasn't coming back soon, that Paul would have taken action. So Paul may have overemphasized the spiritual aspect, but spiritual humility is a practice of acknowledging that there is always more to uncover and learn, always more layers of the divine to be revealed. Spiritual humility means being patient with our own becoming, our own healing, our own growing. It knows that there is nothing to prove to others. There are only ways to grow more deeply into love and justice and community. That's what it means to have the mind of the Christ. When your mind becomes enlightened, when you begin to see things for how they are, then that moves you into wanting to change those things that you see. Spiritual humility is interested in collective freedoms and wholeness more than proving a point or winning an argument. It doesn't seek to control or dominate, but to lift up, to invite, to bring along. Spiritual humility doesn't keep us from striving for social justice with conviction or boldness. It only deepens our approach to the liberating works of God in that it keeps us open to discernment when there needs to be a change in course, when we need to admit we're wrong. It makes us less likely to turn beliefs or commitments into immovable or non-negotiable idols or dogma. And if we live in a manner in which a sacramental sensibility like that is reflected, that all beings are connected to being itself, then the humility that should flow from this knowledge might have a profound effect on how we view not only one another within our spaces, but also those who are marginalized and oppressed outside of our spaces. The mind of the Christ is the ongoing work of marrying together the enfleshed love and tangible work of Jesus that we see modeled throughout the gospel narratives, marrying that with the spiritual and mental transformation that Paul writes of, and doing it all with a sense of humility, understanding that none of us knows the big picture, and none of us have read the last page of the book. And as I shared from Dr. Cohn in our moment of focus, faith is a commitment, a deeply felt experience of being called by the Spirit of Christ to bear witness to God's coming liberation by fighting for the freedom of the poor now. May it be so.
things. You make beautiful things out of us.
Let's engage in a time of prayer and or meditation. Maya Angelou wrote, I did then what I knew how to do. Now that I know better, I do better. When we pray for the courage to be agents of change amidst a chaotic world. We do this with humility, knowing that none of us have all the answers. But we also do so with boldness in order to lift up and to shine on. And we lift up those unspoken of those we love, those we miss, those unspoken who are ill, those who are searching, those receiving medical treatments for physical ailments that we are not aware of, those struggling with mental illness, those who are grieving, those who are angry, those who are depressed, those who feel lost and empty. We lift up those marginalized groups who continue to suffer grave injustices and violence at the hands of authorities. We lift up those politicians and cultural forces who seek to control the bodily autonomy of women and others, and we hope and we pray and we work toward a change in perspective for them. We lift up those who believe gay is a word that cannot be uttered. And we also pray for those who suffer the consequences at the hands of people who believe gay is a word that cannot be uttered. We lift up those lost to senseless gun violence. And for creation, as she continues to suffer and burn, and for our efforts to create an ecological future of health and sustainability. We lift these up to the divine spirit, we present them to the universe, and we offer them to God, however we might define God. And today I added the disciples' prayer because it was requested of me last week that maybe we add something like that. It might be a different disciples' prayer. Some people call it the Lord's Prayer. It might be a different disciples' prayer from what you're normally used to. I'm going to do this for the next few weeks. And for this first week, I'll just read it myself. And then in the following weeks, I think it would be nice if we read it together. Mother of us all, who dwells within and beyond, sacred is your name. May your holy vision for collective flourishing come to fruition among us. May your dreams of justice, love, and compassion and connection be enfleshed on earth. Provide us today with what we need to be nourished in body, soul, and heart. Forgive us for the harm we cause as we seek to forgive those who have harmed us. Lead us away from everything that destroys and liberate us from the hands of evil. For you are the ultimate source of hope. Your power with exceeds all power over. Your presence incites eternal wonder. All praise to you, our comfort and strength. Amen. May it be so.
We will make no peace, no peace, no peace with oppression. We will make no peace, no peace. We will make no peace, no peace, no peace with oppression. We will make no peace, no peace. Those who live by the sword will die by the sword. We will stand against violence.
Beloveds, though the full mystery of God will always remain beyond our grasp, the Spirit gifts us with glimpses of justice, with touches of love, and with whispers of truth. Always and everywhere, the wisdom of the divine is being revealed that we might live and love differently together, free from the ways that destroy and oppress and kill. Sacred mystery surrounds us. And because of that, may we go and seek the mind of the Christ. May it be so. Amen. Have a wonderful week.